We bless you, we praise you. We can never thank you enough, but Lord, we begin by honoring you, by giving you our hearts, by surrendering. Have your way. Lord, we ask and proclaim that you truly are the author and finisher of our faith. We know you can do all things, for greater is he that is in us than he that is in this world. Lord, as we come together, let us come with one heart, one mind, soul, and spirit. Let that a power and anointing be present in your house and upon and in your people as we praise and worship you. Lord, as our voices become a sweet-smelling savior to your ears, Lord, we ask your anointing upon our services completely. Lord, from the top to the floor, to the left, to the right, and everyone that enters through those doors will sense and feel the presence of Jesus Christ. Upon our praise and worship team, as they lead us into the Holy of Holies, upon our pastor that has the word of life, transforming, life-giving, that anointing word, Lord God, give us ears to hear for what you have revealed to him, allowing us to grow. So when we leave this place, we will not leave the same way that we came in. Lord, we've been challenged in allowing your peace and understanding to help us to grow. And Father, we pray for those that are on their way, let them arrive safely. And Lord, for those that are not able to make it, we just pray your blessings and power and healing upon their lives. For all things, Lord God, come from you. And we thank you and bless you as we give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor. For it's in Jesus' name that we ask this prayer. And all God's people said, amen. 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 Please remain standing as our praise and worship team comes.
We give all praise and honor to the Lord. Amen. Thank you for another day. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God.
Every praise is to our God. Every praise.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship we want to pour. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory, hallelujah, is to our God. Every praise is to our God. God, my Savior, God, my Healer, God, my Deliverer. Yes, He is. Yes, He is.
Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Don't do it without me.
Study. Also, Easter is just a couple of weeks away. We're excited about that. Hey, this is a good opportunity to invite your friends, loved ones. This is an awesome opportunity to help and minister to the unchurched. We know if people don't go to church at all, they're at least going to come on Easter and Christmas. And so take this opportunity to invite your friends, those who don't usually go to church, your co-workers, you know, family members, let them come out on that Sunday. They won't be offended at all. It's expected for them to come, and we're going to have the opportunity to minister to them. Amen. Also, now we have May. We'll give you some information. We're getting some details and flyers. We will have a two-night revival Thursday and Friday. On that Wednesday, we won't have Bible study that week, and so we'll have it's just that Thursday and Friday evening. We'll give you some more information about that. All righty. And I'll be able to put up here in a second. Immediately following service, just about 5 minutes or so. Just give me just a couple minutes of your time, those of your members, and we want to meet with you very briefly. All right, if you will, go to 1 Corinthians chapter number 13. 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter, will give you an opportunity to give. First Corinthians 13. We appreciate, certainly appreciate the tithes, offering, gifts of love. This, we were able to share this some of you on Wednesday. Able to put a flat screen in the back with the kids, and they got free streaming live program. So we're able to do that. Thank God for it. And doing a couple things. We're going to upgrade our camera. That camera right there that has the tape on the side, we're going to upgrade that pretty soon. And working on some things even on the outside that we're able to do. So appreciate that, what you give. 1 Corinthians chapter number 1, 13, excuse me, chapter 13. Let's look at verses 1 through 3. It says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not love, I have become a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And though I have all the gifts of prophecy and understand all mysteries, and I have all knowledge and have all faith, so that I can remove mountains, and have not love, I am nothing. Verse 3, for though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. Now, verse 3 talks about how we're generous to give, to help support those in need. But how many of you know that with our tithes, with our offerings, God is also looking at our heart, looking at our motives. And so above everything else, we have to make sure we have a heart to give. You know, it's good to give systematically and by ritual or routine, but how many of you know that God really doesn't need, you know, money per se? All the money really stays here. None of it goes to heaven. But what God is looking at is our heart. And so this verse speaks of the motive behind why we give. Why we give to the poor, why we give those in need, why do we give to those who are doing a good work, and more importantly, why do we invest into God's visible kingdom? Hopefully, we do it because our heart is pure and we have a heart full of the love of God, and that's what he's referring to. The motive behind what we give, I argue, can be just as important, if not more important, than the giving itself. So that's what God wants to remind us of on this morning. All right, give you a couple minutes to get your offering and we'll prepare it, and then we will pray with you thereafter.
It's your season to be blessed. God made you a promise. Heaven, pour your blessing. It's your season. It's your season to be blessed. It's your season
to be blessed.
To be blessed. God gave you a promise. You stood the test.
Windows of heaven.
Windows of heaven.
Pour you out.
Pour you out blessing.
It's your season.
It's your season to be blessed.
I'm blessed in the city and blessed in the field.
I'm blessed in the field.
Blessed going in. Come on.
I'm blessed going out.
Coming in.
I'm blessed going in.
Windows of heaven.
Windows of heaven.
Pour you out a blessing.
Pour you out a blessing.
It's your season.
It's your season.
To be.
To be.
Come on, say it again. It's your season. We believe that.
It's your season. To be blessed.
God made you a promise.
God made you a promise.
You stood.
You stood the test.
Windows of heaven, we believe it.
Windows of heaven.
Pour you out a blessing.
Pour you out a blessing.
It's your season.
It's your season to be blessed.
Amen. Go ahead and rest on your feet. Praise God. Lord. It's good to see. We believe that. We prophesy that over ourselves. It's our season to be blessed. Amen. Let's pray. Father, once again, we thank you for this wonderful privilege and opportunity to invest into your physical kingdom. We count it a privilege and honor to be co-laborers together with you in the Great Commission. And so now, Father, we believe that we receive the return on what we give. We give, Lord, not just out of grudgingly or of necessity, but Father, we give because we love you and we are passionate about everything you stand for. We give your name the praise, honor, and glory for these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Praise the Lord.
Coming in, windows of heaven, pour you out a blessing.
It's your season
to be blessed. It's your season to be blessed. God gave you a promise, you stood the test.
Windows of heaven.
Of heaven, for your blessing, it's your season, fruitful season, it's your season, it's your season, it's your season,
it's your season,
it's your season,
it's my season,
it's my season.
It's your season.
It's your season.
Hallelujah.
It's your season. It's your season. It's your season. It's your season. It's your season.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's your season. 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 It's your season to be back.
Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise, man. Hallelujah. All right. Young people, I have one volunteer, please. Praise the Lord. People always ask me, are y'all streaming today? I said, we are. Okay, thank you so much. We're working on that. Amen, amen. We're trying to get it worked out so when we get a feed through here, it'll record and give us some live footage as well. So we're trying to, technology moves so fast, but I'm just still trying to catch up. So thank you so much. All right, let's give God praise. I appreciate you coming forward for a special musical selection.
God for a mighty breakthrough. Amen.
Amen.
Trust his word is true. Amen. I feel a breakthrough coming your way. It's a mighty move of God. It's going to change your day. The signs and wonders, miracles to perform. God's going to bless you, but just holding on. I feel a breakthrough coming your way. It's a mighty move of God. It's gonna change your day. The signs and wonders, miracles to perform. God's gonna bless you, but just holding on. Just hold on. A change is coming. I feel it in the air. It's in the atmosphere. Just hold on. A change is coming. A move of God is on the way. You've been expecting a change in your life. Looking for your midnight to turn to sunshine. Now it's gonna happen. You wait and see. It's impossible to them that believe. Just hold on, a change is coming. I feel it in the air, it's in the atmosphere. Just hold on, a change is coming. A move of God is on the way. feel a breakthrough coming your way. It's a mighty move of God. It's gonna change your day. The signs and wonders, miracles to perform. God's gonna bless you, but just holding on. I feel a breakthrough coming your way. It's a mighty move of God. It's gonna change your day. The signs and wonders, miracles to perform. God's gonna bless you, but just holding on. Just hold on, a change is coming. I feel it in the air, it's in the atmosphere. Just hold on, a change is coming.
Go ahead and release our children, those five and under, for ministry. Amen. Those of you who remain, you can turn your Bibles to Galatians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2. And we're going to focus our attention on verse number 20. Galatians chapter number 2. And verse number 20. As you're turning there, we'll go ahead and pray. Once again, Father, thank you for this wonderful privilege and opportunity to share your word this morning with your precious people. I pray that you think through my mind, speak through my mouth, that those who are here will be touched, edified, strengthened, and set free. We pray that revelation and knowledge flow freely, and that your word have free course in this place, free from satanic influence. We pray that every ear is anointed to hear, and every heart is receptive to what your spirit would say unto them. Lord, help me to think clearly and to speak intelligently, that those who are here will understand your word. It is our confession this morning that we will not just be hearers of your word, but we will in fact be doers of your word. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. All right, so in Galatians chapter number 2, verse number 20, we've been in a series entitled Living for Christ. Living for Christ, and we've been sharing some things along these lines over the last 3 weeks, and we want to share some additional thoughts this morning. Again, our text scripture is coming from Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I'm reading from the New King James Version of the Bible. And it says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me, and the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Notice the first verse again. Is that I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. And so this morning we're using as a subject, commitment to a cause. Commitment to a cause. As we said, in the last couple of weeks, we've been teaching from the series entitled Living for Christ. We said this involves several things for the believer. It involves us submitting ourselves to God. It also involves us giving our bodies to the Lord. It involves sacrifice and living a holy life. It also involves going after God and pursuing Him. In addition to this, we want to share this morning that if we're really going to live for Him, it's going to involve us being committed to a cause. Now, 16 years ago, 19 hijackers came to our country, took over planes, and we know the rest of the story. They had 4 planes, and they did a lot of damage, two of which went to the World Trade Center. And these 19 hijackers, they came to our country. Some of them have been in the country for 10 years. And up to that point, their entire existence was based upon that one day. They gave their life to that particular cause. They believed in it. Obviously, we don't believe in their religion, but you cannot question their commitment. And they were committed to their cause. Now, as Christians, you know, God hasn't called us to be martyrs. I don't believe that. You know, He told us He wants us to be a living sacrifice. But how many of you know God wants us to be committed to Him? And we do have a cause. There is a cause that the believer should be committed to. And that's what we want to talk about today. When you talk about commitment to a cause, the word cause means a belief. It means a purpose. It means a mission. And so, as a child of God, my life should have purpose. There should be a mission that I adhere to for my life while I'm here on earth. And when you talk about the cause that we're committed to, we know that this is a cause that is greater than self. This is the cause of living for Christ, making His name great, and doing what pleases Him. And so we have to be committed to this particular cause, where commitment means obligation, it means devotion, it means allegiance, it means loyalty, it means that I have a duty. It also means that there is a promise that I made to God to do something. It also means a charge. Somebody say charge.
Charge.
Kind of reminds me of the song that is entitled, A Charge to Keep I Have. How many of y'all remember that song? It says, A Charge to Keep I Have, a God to glorify, every dying soul to save is fitting for the sky. The second verse reads this way. To serve this present age, my calling to fulfill. Oh, may it all my powers engage to do His will. There's a charge that I have to keep, and that's what God is telling us through this verse. There's a cause we have to be committed to. And when you talk about being committed to a cause, it speaks of salvation. It speaks about becoming a new creature in Christ. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, we don't have it here, but it says that if any man is in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. It involves us making Jesus the Lord of our lives. Pastor, after we get saved, how soon should we be committed to the cause of living for Christ? Well, I would tell you as soon as possible. How many of you know that Jesus said, today, if you hear my voice, harden not your heart. In addition to that, we know tomorrow isn't promised to us. All we really are guaranteed is now, is today. Not only that, we understand that time is of the essence. We know people are dying every single day without Christ. The Bible says that hell is enlarging yourself. Right now, we need committed people. We need people to be committed to this cause, because churches every day are struggling to find people to help carry the weight of responsibilities that come on ministries. And so this is the time to be committed to the cause. As soon as you give your life and your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ, God needs you to be committed. How many of you remember the story of the lady who came to Jesus? Samaritan woman, I believe it was. And she met Jesus at the well. And He began to prophesy to her. And He said, lady, you don't know who you're talking to. And He began to tell her how many husbands she had and the people she was running with. And the Bible said there was a conversion that took place within her life immediately. Somebody say immediately.
Immediately.
She gave her life to Jesus Christ. The Bible says she dropped her water pots, just left them there. She went throughout the whole city and says, come see a man who told me everything I ever did. She didn't take a whole long time. She didn't take 5, 6, 7 years to determine whether or not she was really going to be committed to Jesus. The Bible says immediately she went and told everybody that she could find about the man Jesus Christ. How many of y'all remember the story with Paul? At that Damascus road experience, the Bible said a light shone from heaven and the Lord addressed his life right there on that road. The Bible says, if I can just make the long story short, that after he was met by the Lord Jesus, he was baptized and immediately, somebody say immediately.
Immediately.
He didn't go to seminary. He didn't go try to get, you know, counsel per se. I understand the benefit behind all that. He didn't try to get a degree in homiletics or anything. He didn't try to get a master's PhD. In Bible theology, and I understand there's value in that, but the Bible says as soon as God touched his life, he went to the whole city and preached Christ everywhere. And so as soon as we get saved, we need to be committed to this cause, Pastor, why is this so important? Let me digress a little bit, because you know what I know about this in my life, because when I got saved, now you understand that I didn't get saved by mistake or just by happenstance. I didn't get saved or come to the altar just because of guilt. And it wasn't necessarily because my grandfather was a pastor or my father was a minister and a deacon. God, he really did a work in my heart. He really did a work in my heart. And as soon as I got saved, I immediately became committed to the cause. How do you know? I immediately got baptized and I joined the church. I said, I'm ready. It's called buying in. How many of you know as Christians, we have to buy in to the gospel, to the cause of Christ? Oh, it's easy to come to church Sunday after Sunday, but have you really bought in? It's just like going to work. Now, you go to work every single week to get a paycheck, but how many of you know having a job is one thing, but buying into the mission and vision of that organization you work for is a totally different thing. And so as Christians, he says, when you're saved, immediately, I want you to buy in. I want you to take ownership of this great gospel. I want you to be committed to a cause. Pastor, why is this important? Why is it so important that we be committed to a cause? That is the cause of Christ. Well, how many of you know that unless, get this now, there is a cause greater than self that you are living for, your life really doesn't have any purpose. That just simply means if you're not committed, if there's not a cause greater than self, then you're just living to pay bills. You're just in survival mode. You're just trying to make money, amass wealth. What purpose does our life serve? How many of you know, for all of us, there is a greater purpose. There's a greater purpose than us just building wealth. There's a greater purpose than just moving to the top of the corporate ladder and leaving an inheritance for our children. There's a greater purpose than going week after week just to be able to pay your bills. There's a cause greater than self that we all have mandated on our lives, and that's why it's so important. Second, we understand it's important because we have the responsibility of convincing others. How many of you know, if you're not committed to the cause, then no one else will. People in your circle of influence, those who watch you every single day, how in the world can we convince other people to be committed to Christ and we're not committed ourselves? We backslide between Sunday. We try to determine whether I'm saved or whether I'm not saved. We're trying to determine whether I'm really going to buy into this whole thing called church, whether I'm going to give my heart and my life to the call, the mandate that God has assigned me to do. And oh, by the way, there is a call. There is an assignment for your life, whether you're called to the fivefold ministry or not. And again, how can we convince other people to be committed to the Lord Jesus, to this great cause of ours, if we're not committed ourselves? Let's take just a little poll here. I would argue the only reason why y'all come to church consistently, because you saw someone in your life who was committed to the cause. Am I right about it? Most of us was a parent, but some of y'all had a drug problem too now. y'all were drunk in church too. Don't act like you don't do drugs, because you had a drug habit as well. Your parents had a habit of dragging you to church. They were committed, and so you had, as long as you were in their house, you had better been committed too, correct? And so likewise, if we're going to reproduce ourselves in other people, if we're going to pass down our faith to the next generation, we better be committed as well. Not only that, when we're committed to the cause, this is so important because this is what pleases God. Now, truth be told, nobody likes an uncommitted person. Am I right about it? Carol does real estate. And time to time, she has some houses that are older that she has to sell, and a lot of work needs to be done. Well, good help is hard to find. I had to start doing a lot of the work, the small job. Not, you know, I ain't trying to remodel something old house. I can't do that. I mean, I guess I could, but it takes me a long time. Get it right at the third try. And so sometimes she calls people, these rascals never show up. You find somebody who knows what they're doing, that's the level of expertise. They promise they're going to meet us at a certain time. Guess what? They don't show up. And so sometimes I have to really do the work because I'm the one she can really depend on to show up. Come on, ladies, you're the same way. You don't want a man who's not really committed, do you?
Nope.
There was a couple, I had to go here now. Got married, went on the honeymoon, had a fantastic time, came back. First day back, husband went to work, and the wife said, I guess I'm going to make him just a nice dinner. Again, nobody wants someone who's not committed. And so he's 3 hours late. Wife said, where in the world? He walks to the door. She said, where in the world have you been? He said, oh, I'm sorry, I forgot. I left work and I went to mama's house for dinner. Nobody likes a person who's not. He's like, you're going to be committed to me, or you're going to be committed to her. There's a man who moved his girlfriend. He said, I love you so much, girl. I will travel through the driest desert. I will cross the most raging sea. I will climb the highest mountain for you. And if it doesn't rain on Sunday, I'll see you. You want people who want to be committed, correct?
Yes.
Nobody likes an uncommitted person. And how many of you know God is the exact same way? Mm-hmm. He wants us to be committed to a cause. That's what he's looking for. It's, get this now, especially in this day and age, when it seems like certain denominations, it's well reported, a lot of mainline denominations, they're losing attendance. See, that pastor's frustrated in the ministry. And not only that, he needs committed people. People are going to be committed to this cause to make up for those who are just kind of one day to the end, one day to the out. And so he's looking for, hey, this is what pleases Almighty God. That's why it's so important. Now, how can we do this? How can a Christian become committed to a cause? I found it involves three areas, among others. Number one is your association. Somebody say association.
Association.
Number two, we have to adhere to God's word. Somebody say adhere,
adhere.
And third, we need to address. Somebody say address.
Address.
We address things in your life that stand in the way of your commitment to a cause. Number one, again, we have to involve our association. Number two, we have to adhere to God's word. Number three, we have to address things in our life that stand in the way of our commitment to a cause. So first we said that to be committed to a cause, it's going to involve our association. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 27, verse 17, that as iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. How many know your friends, your association are very important? We're going to get to that. The Bible also says in Proverbs chapter 22, verse 20, he said that you may walk in the way of good men. Notice this. He said follow. This one translation says follow the steps of good men instead. And then, one translation said, then you will be able to stay on the path of the righteous. You know why sometimes we fall by the wayside, why we don't stay on the path of the righteous? Because we're not following, and we're not associated with good men. Good women, in other words. Your association means everything. Show me a person's friends, I'll show you their future. In fact, Paul said it this way, he said, don't be fooled now. Bad company will corrupt good manners. Why would he say that? Because he said there's people in the church, body of Christ, those who are saved, who think they can associate with the wrong people and it not affect them at all. He said, don't be fooled. It always affects you. Now, I understand this because other than Jesus himself, my association probably was the single most reason I remained committed to the cause. My association. First of all, my grandfather, he was sick, he was pastor. My father, he was radically saved. I saw it right before my eyes. Mentors, my contemporaries, this, I can't overstate this. Your association impacts your life in ways you have undervalued. In my life, even today, as a pastor, the thing that really helps me to stay committed to this cause, oh yeah, I do have good days and bad days too. Don't make a mistake about it. I do have days when I'm scratching my head. I do have days when I'm frustrated. Let me tell you what, sometimes depression will try to come to me as well. You know why I stay committed to a cause? Because of people in my life, association, pastors who I fellowship with, my contemporaries. I'm not talking about the ones who are frustrated in the ministry, getting ready to leave. I'm not talking about unethical ones. I'm talking about those who can encourage me, those who are committed to the cause of Christ, those who can challenge me. And so it is with your life as well. There is no way you'll stay committed to Jesus, to live for Christ, if you are constantly associated with people who are halfway saved. You have to have the right people around you, people who are going to challenge you, motivate you. I'm talking about people who, when you're living in sin, they love you enough to tell you you're wrong.
Yes.
It's time to get back on track now. God has deposited too much on the inside of you for you to go someplace where you don't need to go. Say things you don't need to say and embrace people you don't need to embrace. People will love you enough to tell you when you're wrong. And it's time to get out of bed and go to church. Association. I see it all the time. People come to church, then they get hooked up with friends, and all of a sudden, you don't see them anymore. Association. If we're going to be committed, this is what it means. Second one we said is, if we're going to be committed to the cause, we have to adhere. Somebody say adhere, adhere. We have to adhere to God's word. Psalm 119. Psalm 119, 105. He says, your word is a lamp unto my feet. Notice he said, your word, the Bible, in other words, the word of God is a lamp to my feet, a light to my path. The word of God lights up my life. It lights up my path. Are you with me? See, that's why the Bible says the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. The Lord orders my steps. How? By his word. His word orders my steps. It orders my life. And so if I'm going to be committed to this great cause, that is living for Christ, I need to adhere to God's word. Now, the word adhere means steady devotion. See, steady. You got some people who are saved, and they're like just a rocket. They're like, woo, Jesus, woo, way up in there. And all that emotion runs out, they go, boom. Come on, right back down to the ground. See? Get excited. Radically want to win the world for Jesus. All of a sudden, you don't see it anymore. I know some people, they used to evangelize constantly. I know because one of the people they evangelized was me. They invited me to church. I mean, just all so zealous for the things of God. So zealous for the things of God make you feel bad about yourself. See? Somebody say steady, steady, steady.
Steady.
Right now, the person won't even go to church anymore. Steady devotion, consistency, constant. That's what it means to adhere to God's word. Adhere means also allegiance. It means support. See, God has our support. Support or an attachment. And this is what the Bible does. God's words defines the cause we're committed to. Let me tell you what, the further we move away from God's word, the less committed we will be. Can we agree that it is impossible to be committed to a cause if you're a Christian, if you don't follow and obey God's word? It's impossible. Because the word outlines our cause. Look at this real quick. Go to Hebrews chapter 12. Also be committed to a cause. We must address things. This is most important. We have to address things in our lives that stand in the way of our commitment to a cause that is living for Christ. Again, verse 1 out of Hebrews 12. It said, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside. Somebody say, lay aside.
Lay aside.
Lay aside some weights. Is that what it says?
Oh,
no, every single weight. Every weight. Didn't even say sin yet. You know, there's certain things in our lives that are not necessarily a sin, but it's certainly a weight. Paul said it this way, all things are not lawful for me, or all things may not be lawful, but all things are expedient. In other words, there may be some things that are legal for me to do, but I just don't need to get involved with it. That's called a weight. He said, lay aside every weight, and the sin which so easily, not even a hard thing, ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Again, he's writing to Christians. He says, Christians have weights, Christians have sin in their lives, and it easily sets them off track. It easily allows them to not be committed anymore. And so we have to, get this now, address these things. Now hear me, this can involve a whole lot of things. It can involve your schedule. I know some people, they can't get to church. They work too much. I suggest you may need to think about taking a different job. Work schedule. See, you have to address these things. And they can't even come Wednesday. They can't even come Wednesday. They can't come evening service. They can't ever come. See, work schedule. Or just schedule in general. Certain relationships. You got to address these things. Certain relationships. Heard something this week. And this article I was reading just as I was studying. And so it was, oh, Lord Jesus. No, my son, my daughter is dating someone who's not saved. How many of you know they had a right to be worried? Are you with me? Because that has to be addressed. Pastor, I can change him. I can change her. Look at your neighbor and say, stop it.
Stop.
Just stop it. Come on, man. That's old. And the kids say, that's dead. That won't work. God had a hard enough time changing you. You can change somebody else. Just stop it. I was going to be unequally ill. The parents said, oh my God, my child is dating someone who's not safe. Because what happens is you have to address these things that will prevent you from being committed to a cause. You can't be a Christian, you marry a Muslim or a non-believer, an atheist. It's going to affect you. You're not going to be committed. Also, habits, sinful addiction, as we said, relationships, ourselves. Somebody say ourselves.
Ourselves.
Sometimes you got to address things within yourself. I rose my hand first. Sometimes our own spiritual apathy, our own lackadaisical attitude that is within ourselves, we have to address these things if we're going to be committed. How many of you know that comes to everybody?
Yes.
I don't feel like going to church today. I don't feel like praying today. Come on now, you got to raise your hand to this. Don't got to say amen, because you're human. I don't feel like reading my Bible today. I don't, praise the word, I don't feel like singing today. I don't feel like practicing today. I don't feel like working with these kids today. They get on my, last week they got on my nerve. I don't feel, I need a break. I need about 2 weeks. I need a month off. I don't feel like working children's ministry today. How many of you know, we don't volunteer for the ministry, nothing will get done. I don't feel like going to Bible study this week. I don't feel like praying with somebody in that prayer room today. Help, nobody raise their hand to be saved. Oh, nobody raise their hand today to give their life to be rededicated. I don't feel like that today. And the last person got on my nerve and they act like they didn't kick aside. What do you want to do? Come on now, come on. You know how it is. I don't feel like praying for someone to be filled with the Spirit today because they always take forever to be filled. See, attitude. I don't feel like preaching today. I don't feel like counseling today. I don't feel like going to this meeting today. All lack of days. I'm tired of going to church. See, you have that option. I don't even have that option. Well, I don't feel like going to church. I gotta come. Praise the Lord. A whole lackadaisical attitude you got to deal with. You have to address. Somebody say address, address. Address these things. It's the enemy in me. It's that doggone man, that woman in the mirror. Sometimes I'm my worst enemy because of my lackadaisical attitude. Sometimes I just get a little too lazy, not diligent enough. And listen, there's a cause greater than self here. Souls are dying every single day. God is counting on us. We are his hands. We are his feet. We are his voice here on earth. God has no spare tires. We're it. Yes. And if his own very people are committed to a cause, then who's going to be committed? Come on now. Those 19 hijackers, they said, listen, this is our baby. We're doing this ourselves. They gave their life to their cause. We can argue with their religion. You can't question their commitment, though. We have to address these things. God told Abraham, son, you're going to be committed. You got to address some things in your life. Get out of your country. Get out of your father's house. Then he said, I'm not even done with you. You need to separate yourself from Lot. Somebody say address.
Address.
See? That's what he had to do. Jesus told the rich young ruler, you got to address some things in your life. You're going to be committed to me. I want you to sell everything you have and give to the poor. God told Peter, he said, if you want to be committed, you got to get over your racism. Because see, Peter didn't think. See, God was grafting the Gentiles in. And Peter was like, I ain't never seen nothing like this. God had to give him a vision. God had to give him a dream. Even Paul had to correct him. You better get over your racism. Because if you're going to be committed to my cause. Sometimes there are things within our life we better address. Or we can't be committed the way God wants us to be. And how many of you know that when you address these things, you do so with the choices you make every single day? See, your choices determine whether you're really committed to the cause or not. You can never hide your commitment because your commitment or lack thereof can't always be seen. I notice choices. Listen, to this day, I'm addressing things in my life. To this day. So I can be more committed, number one, to Jesus and the assignment that God has given me. All right, I talk about you a whole lot. Can I make a confession? You got to address some things in my life. There's one thing I had to deal with, because sometimes you never know what's going on the inside of an individual. You know one thing I had to address in my life? Tell the truth, shame the devil. I said, you know what? The thought come to my mind, you know, if this pastoring thing don't work, what career am I going to? I can do a principal, I got a little bit of education, I can do that, I can do this. Somebody say address.
Address.
Address these things. Like Paul, woe unto me if I preach not to God. If I have to stand on a corner and preach, if I have to go to the jails or the hospitals and preach, one thing I better be doing, I better be preaching. Amen. See? What I do Monday through Friday, that's my job. This is my career. Gotta address these things. Burn my bridges. I'm in for the long haul. Committed. Julius Caesar, when he was in Britain, I was going to share this. They're going to battle. And took his men off to the edge of a cliff. He told them, I want you to look down. And as they looked down, they saw all of the ships that they traveled in to get to where they were in flames, burning up. He said, I did this on purpose. So you know there's no going back. So you can be committed. You can't go back. I burned all the planes, all the ships. The only thing you got to do now, you got to move forward. You got to win the fight. How many of you know, listen, sometimes you have to burn your bridges
to show God you're committed. And when it comes to the cause of Christ, you have to address those things. Let me tell you, Peter, he had to address the fear in his life to be committed to the cause. He was too afraid to get out of the boat to go to Jesus. Sometimes there are fears we have. There's a lot of things sometimes we have that we have to address that is standing in the way of us. I mean, really, not just lip service, but really being committed to a cause. I'm telling you what, we talk about the drunk, the wino, the homosexual, but we got a lot of stuff on the inside of us that keeps us at average spiritually. A lot of things, man. We love to point the finger. Oh, look, they got a child of wedlock. They're homosexual. They're drinking. They're lying. Listen, I don't drink, smoke, or chew, or even hang out with those who do. Look at that old rotten sinner. And God said, listen, you haven't even addressed the things in your life. You're still giving me just half effort, per se. Are you really committed? Easy to point the finger to see these external things, but have you addressed these things within your life that are standing in the way of you being committed to the cause? So we said it involves three things: our association. We have to hear God's word. We have to address these things in our lives. 1976 in the Olympics. Zach, you loved this. There's a gymnast. I want to say he's from Japan. And he's representing his country. He's going for a gold medal. On the floor exercises, he broke his right knee. They said, how do you feel? Well, my knee's broken. What do you think? But he still had one more event, the rings. And that was the strongest event. And with a broken knee, he went on the rings. And he went up, did a triple somersault, and he went down on his feet, and he nailed it. He nailed it with a broken right knee. They asked him afterwards. He said, did it hurt? He said, the pain was so great, it felt like a knife just shot right through me. The pain was so great, it brought tears to my eyes. But now I have a gold medal. I don't feel any pain anymore. He was committed to representing his country. He was committed to his sport. He was committed to those events. And he was able to win. Get this now. He did it for a natural medal. We're trying to get a supernatural medal. If a natural man for a natural medal can be committed to the point that he flies in the air with a broken knee, so much so that he refuses, hear me, please hear me, that he refuses to quit just because he's representing his country, just because he deemed that to be a cause greater than self, greater than the pain I'm facing right now, just because he wanted to get that gold medal. I only got one time in my life to probably do this. He went all out. He was committed. Then what about us as Christians? Why can't we be committed to this cause, this great cause that is greater than self? And that's what God asks us to do. We have to hear to God's word. We have to have the right kind of association around us. We have to address all these things that are in our life that stand in the way of our commitment to Jesus. Commitment to a cause. Go ahead and rest on your feet. You want to pray. Those of you who weren't here Wednesday, Sunday evening, I know, I think Brother Gibson used the same example about the chicken and the hen. It just was so fitting about really being committed to the cause of Christ. And they wanted a prepare a meal. The chicken said, I'll tell you what, I'll provide the egg, you provide the bacon. The hog said, well, shoot, man, you just making a donation. You asking for a full commitment out of me. How many of you know that we're the hog, and that's what God is asking for? He said, I want you to make a full commitment. I want you to sacrifice. And let me tell you, we do understand sacrifice. We do a whole lot. We committed, and we sacrifice a whole lot for the mighty dollar, don't we? For that paycheck. We go in tired. Sometimes we don't have, you know, if we don't have any sick days left, sometimes we will press our way to go sick because I don't want the doctor, my paycheck, and leave my money. We will go in tired. We will go in sick. If they're paying us enough, We'll put up with a nagging loss. We'll get on our last nerve. But we'll stay longer than we wanted to. Because we committed to that dollar. And so, we have a cause that's greater than the dollar, greater than self. We have to be committed to it. This is where we are as the church, I believe. Because people who follow a false god, false religion, will give their very life. And I'm not saying only God wants to be a martyr, but it is amazing. They believe that Muslims, a lot of them, you know, radical Islam and just Muslims in general, they believe that they are faithful and loyal to Allah. They'll wake up the next morning after death. Number one, they'll be a national hero. And number two, they'll wake up, sorry ladies, in paradise with ladies all around. That's what they believe. And they said, well, shoot, that's not too bad. I'll be a hero. My family, I'll make my family's name great. I'll wake up in paradise with ladies all around me. And just because of that thing, they say, I'll give my life. You got kids doing the same thing. Kids strap themselves with bombs. How do you convince a child to do that? I don't know. But they believe in full commitment. God doesn't even want you to be a martyr. He said, can we be committed to this cause? Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we love you. We bless your name. We honor you. Thank you for being so committed to us. When we weren't committed to you, you loved us before we loved you. You gave your very life. You gave it all just for every person who's here today. Thank you so much. We never want to take that for granted. You loved us so much. I'm talking about times where people turned their back on us, when people we thought we can count on and who loved us unconditionally showed us another side. You were always there. You never leave us, never forsake us. You were there in the past, you're there now, and you will be there. When life is hard and people turn their back on us, you will always be there. You've always been so faithful. You've always been so kind. You've always been so loving. No matter the hang-ups we have, idiosyncrasies, shortcomings, and weaknesses, you loved us in spite of those things. You've always been committed to us. And so, Father, it's not a hard thing or even unreasonable for you to expect a level of commitment from us, commitment to this cause. So many different causes, great causes out there. Cancer research, protecting the lives of the unborn, those who do AIDS research, and those who are trying to find medical cures. They give their life for this great cause. It's a great cause. Those who work with special needs children, they don't do it for the money, they do it for the cause. Those who work with the elderly, caregivers, they're doing it because of the cause. And likewise, we have a cause. Charge to keep, I have a God to glorify. Every dying soul to save. It's fit for this guy. Help us, Lord, today to embrace this cause, this need that's greater than self. Help us to understand and embrace the enormity of the responsibility that rests upon each one of our lives. So we can represent you in the best possible way and help, and so we can push the gospel forward. So our life can have purpose, so it can have real meaning. We understand, God, that you are our purpose. Let everything else fall by the wayside. So God, we bless you. And we praise you for these things. In the name of Jesus, we bless you. We worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to be praised. We give you all the glory.
We give you
we give you all.
much.
Lord, we give it to you.
We hear you. Oh,
we love you. We love you.
The Lord.
God, we commit it to you.
We worship you.
Before we leave out of here, if you're here today and you're not saved, or you want to be filled with the Spirit or rededicated to the Lord, you can raise your hand. We pray with you. And we're committed to the cause. We'll wait on you. If you desire to be saved, if you're not saved, you desire to be filled with the Spirit, and you're not filled, if you desire to rededicate your life to the Lord, then that is you. Father, if you're here, if you desire to be a member of Lighthouse Christian Center, then raise your hand. We will receive you into our local congregation in the name of Jesus. And Father, as we leave this place, but never from your presence, we pray that you see this word this morning within our heart. Remind us of these things so we can gauge our level of commitment to you in the name of Jesus. Help us be aware that we have a cause greater than self. Something bigger than us that we have to live for, that you've called us to. And Father, it is our confession that we're not to be hearers of your word, but we will in fact be doers of your word. In Jesus' name, we give your name the praise, we give your name the honor, and we give your name the glory. In Jesus' name we pray, amen, amen. And amen. Somebody give God a hand clap. God bless you. We trust the word today has been a blessing to your life. Before I shake a few hands if I need to, and then in about 5 to 8 minutes, we're going to have a brief meeting for our members, and we'll share some things with you. Amen. Love on someone before you leave. We will see you again.